spread the gift of the gospel to the world. Well, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries.
To it the message that I will tell you. So and all of them, great and small, put on sackcloth. When God saw by their actions how they turned from their evil way, he repented of the evil that he had threatened to do to them. He did not carry it out. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
This is the time of fulfillment. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel. As he passed by the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting their nets into the sea. They were fishermen. Jesus said to them, "Come after me, and I will make you fishers of men." Then they abandoned their nets and followed him. He walked along a little farther and saw James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John. They too were in the boat, mending their nets. And he called them. So they left their father Zebedee in the boat, along with his hired men, and followed him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
And Jesus came to Galilee proclaiming the Gospel. Well, gospel is a word that means good news, and it really is the good news that he's announcing the fact that God's kingdom has already begun to be present in the world, not fully present, because that's going to depend upon how it's received. You know, before the Lord, which we're going to get on later on in the gospel, but we've heard it before, he uses little parables and stories to try to help us understand the kingdom of heaven is like. We all recall about, you know, the mustard seed, the little tiny seed begins small and then it will grow to a large crop, big enough for the birds of the sky to come and make a nest in it. He also said, the kingdom of heaven is like leaven, yeast, that's kneaded into, wow, 50 pounds of flour. It will start being small. It will then continue to grow and affect the whole batch. Well, certainly Christ has come to announce the beginning of the advent of the kingdom of God, right in our midst of his very presence and by his very preaching. So we realize that it's like maybe those in Jesus' day, the disciples too, the ones who are being called in this gospel passage, that it should just come, boom, now it's here. You know, the Romans were ours, and all justice is made right, all evil is done. Christ has conquered Satan already. Remember when he was tempted in the desert. But now he begins the process of spreading that good news out into the world. And he will need to call others to be a part of that very process of announcing that good news. We'll hear more about that next week. But right now we hear that Jesus comes. There is the shadow of the cross there too. We realize that it's not going to be an easy road. Because it mentions about John and all those who are prophetic, those who are speaking the word of God, those who are trying to proclaim the good news of the kingdom, they're going to have a hard way to go. John is arrested. Now, I kind of wonder what the motivation is behind that. Well, we know that John was not afraid to challenge the king, the tetrarch, really, of his lifestyle, that he was supposed to be a model. Living and certainly was supposed to be upholding the law of God and helping it to be promulgated in the community and practiced and lived. Good luck. That's not what he did. And remember his wife, Rebecca, you know, my wife, the most incestuous relationship that he had. She didn't like the idea of him saying those kind of things in public. They were going to do it. She didn't like it. So she had her way. But maybe there were some political issues there too, because John attracted many people listening to his preaching, even though he was saying repent. And you saw them coming forward. And they went into the water to be baptized, to actually admit their sins, and to acknowledge they needed to change. They needed to change, a change of heart, a change of mind, a change of life. So we heard that throughout our Advent celebration when John the Baptist was preaching. Maybe the people were questioning, you know, what's going on with the guy? Look at those people, and look at this, look at that. When John was trying to help people get morally straight in the right relationship with God and with one another, people could obviously see it wasn't happening in their world. And it was going to be a matter of each person accepting this gift and then living it. Because there was terrible injustice. There was unfairness all over the place. There was not the right kind of worship happening in the temple. There was abuse here, there, and everywhere. It was there. Systemic problems that needed to be faced and changed. And if each person would open themselves up to the gift of God's grace and accepting God's rule in their life, then things could change. So, as he passed the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon, his brother Andrew, cast back nets. He calls them. And Jesus' word is powerful. And to be able to touch a life and change it in such a very quick and powerful way, I think those who have been on different kinds of retreats maybe have heard various kinds of sermon, or maybe at least being a part of some youth involved in the youth in China, encounter Christ. Maybe in Collinsville, maybe another movement, you know, Christ renews his parish, all kinds of different events that kind of bring people into a quiet moment and listen. And listening to the call of the Lord that can really touch and change our hearts and our lives. And oftentimes, you know, we may have the greatest of intentions as we hear that word spoken. Sometimes we're a bit hesitant to take the step to make that change. To do what's necessary to really make it effective in our life or in our family. The second is being Sunday, which is called the Sunday of the Word of God. Pope Francis initiated that in December of last year. Very close to our time, obviously, it's not that many weeks ago. But it was kind of drawing attention to the Word of God and how powerful and important it is for us to be attuned to it. He really wants us to understand how the church works so hard to create these three-year cycle of readings so we get exposed to the Old Testament, the New Testament, the Gospel, all of the Gospels. So hearing that word is going to move us to understand how and what we are going to do in life to grow in that relationship with God. Well, then why don't we take it home? What do we do about it? Well, some people have joined together in study groups. Some have used the word mama. Some have used those other little reflection books that they may have in habits. Some come online and can be listening. Jesus, he asked his common disciples, and he will entrust them with great responsibility. We can't say, oh, that's them, that's those guys back then. No. He wants us, Mark wants us to hear, we are being called. And he wants us to hear that voice. Repent and put your faith in the gospel. Take a second look at where you're going, what your life is like, the things that may be hindering you or bothering you. Look again and listen to this good news, presence of the Lord. Well, let's look back to the Old Testament, the first lesson tonight. It's kind of fun, you might want to read it, but it's about Jonah. And I was calling him a reluctant prophet. Jonah was a real person to live much earlier than this book was written, but the author just borrowed his name and some of the things he did, and yet he creates this short story. Teaches a lesson. He was doing it, of course, for the community that to which he was preaching, you know, writing. There's only five Hebrew words that this prophet says in the whole of the book. Only five words. And keep eight in English. But what is his call? The Lord wanted him to go and speak to the people of Nineveh. Remember, Nineveh happens to be the capital of the wicked Assyrian. It was considered the worst of the worst of the worst of the worst. I mean, it was just hated and dreaded by everybody in the world at that time because they were the ones who were imposing themselves on everyone. And so the Lord gave them a task to Jonah to preach the word. Repent or servant. And he was telling God that that was wrong for him to be kind enough and compassionate enough to share that kind of forgiveness with him. No, don't give him a chance. Just do it. So the story goes, he takes off in the direction of the ship, and then that's when he gets swallowed by the fish, and he's viewed back up on the shore, and he goes to the middle of it, and he preaches the word, and he's just getting partly started into the city, and boom! Everybody listens, from the king on down. They put on sackcloth and ashes. Sounds familiar? We usually don't like the sackcloth part, but we do little ashes and ash ones. Signify repentance, a willingness to make that change. We're going to listen to the Lord's word. We're going to act on that word. So he wants to know what this happens in his name. He can't stand it. How could God show kindness and compassion to those enemies? Part of the book, of course, is trying to help the community realize, wait a minute, God is the God of everyone. And you can't realize that. Deeply compassionate he is to show him to us for our failures and to everyone else as well. Okay, so when the Lord Jesus comes, what's he doing? He's making this great announcement. He's involving others involved in the great work that's going to be the sign to do the very same thing, announcing the good news. We're not the same, and then we're going to save. Mercy and forgiveness in our life. So attentive to the word is so important. The focus, of course, is Jesus. He's the initiator. He calls, not in a private way, but he calls these guys to be part of a community. And together they're going to go forth into the world. That's what we are. Called as a community, and together we will spread. Now we help each other to keep growing when we fall down, when we make mistakes and we choose other things. But that grace is there, continuing to call, continuing to invite. So may the Lord grace us this evening as we celebrate this Mass today to realize the enormous creative power, that enormous compassion of God that reaches out to all, that we would be touched by that. That we embrace that, and that we share that. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the God of us, Lord of the Father before all ages, God of God, light of light, God of God, beyond not me, consubstantial. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, we praise and thank you for sending us your Son, announcing the news, calling us to repentance and to change of heart. We turn now to you in our petitions and prayers.
That the Church will continue to call us to be faith-filled disciples, gathering all to share the kingdom of God, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the Lord will bless our nation and especially those newly installed, to address the many challenges, protecting and preserving our unity and peace. to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Let our parish family help us to take seriously our missionary call, reaching out and inviting in to prayer, sincere hospitality, generous serving and giving. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we will foster a deeper respect for all human life as a precious gift from God, as well as reverencing and protecting all of God's creation. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the sick will know the healing presence of Christ, his comfort and peace through the sacraments of the Church. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who have died may be welcomed into the joys of the their eternal home in heaven, with prayers for Angelo for Pharaoh, together with Elmer Kirkemeyer, Bob O'Burrow, Kevin Moore, and Celia Dixon. Also, all the victims of the pandemic, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We offer a prayer of thanksgiving to God for the gift of the vaccine. We pray for a safe distribution and a quick administration so we can find need, healing, and health. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
Almighty and eternal God, our refuge in every danger, to whom we turn in our distress and faith we pray, look with compassion upon the afflicted. Grant eternal rest to the dead, comfort to mourners, healing to the sick, peace to the dying. Strength and health to our workers, wisdom to our leaders, and the courage to reach out to all in love, so that together we may give glory to your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
For those
servants, we give you ceaseless thanks for the choirs of heaven. We cry out to your majesty on earth, and without end we acclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." By the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope of the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory of
God. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I give you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously care for peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord.
My Jesus, I believe you are present in the most holy sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to receive you into my soul. Since I cannot at this moment receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. I embrace you as if you were already there and unite myself wholly to you. Never permit me to be separated from you.
Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that receiving the grace by which you bring us to new life, we may always glory in your gift. Through Christ our Lord. Time changes obviously in our country, good and gracious God, please grant us the courage and invitation of our missionary disciples. Grant us the gift of hospitality, showing openness and love to all. Make us a prayer.